Okay, so in continuation of the earlier lecture, now we are going to discuss about that how to develop the knowledge management system. So basically here what we are going to cover is that how we are going to build different layers of the KM system. Okay, and basically we have already talked about it in a little bit in the earlier module, but here we are going to discuss it in detail about each layer and how each layer gets connected and integrated with other layers. It is very, very important to develop the knowledge management system along these layers so that it works effectively. And these layers include interface layer, access and authentication layer, collaborative and filtering and intelligence layer, and then we have application layer and transport layer. Then we have middleware and legacy integration, and finally we have repository layer. So we'll discuss about each one of them in some detail. So we start with the first part, that is the interface layer. Interface layer, if you look at this figure, it shows that how the person is going to interface with the KM system. Okay, so this layer actually basically is the primary contact point between the users and the KM system content. So suppose you want to access the content from the KM system as a user, so this is the layer where you are going to interact with the system. Okay, and basically it provides you a channel for accessing both kind of knowledge, that is tacit as well as explicit. Okay, now if you look at this, you can find out that how the information moves from one person to another person. Okay, now if you look at this, there are two processes which have been shown here, this internalization and externalization. So if you look at this internalization process, what happens, that is related to tacit knowledge which is moving from one person, this is from this person to this person through internalization. So the information is internalized and then he is going to understand and make use of it, that is related to tacit knowledge. Okay, so this is more personal, which is moving from one person to another person. Now if you look at explicit knowledge, that is in the form of externalization. So what happens, the knowledge is there in the system and then the person is going to make use of that system, and that is what we know as externalization. Okay, so when we talk about transferring tacit knowledge, that is between two people, when one person transfers the knowledge to the other person. Okay, so it is in the form of tacit knowledge, and when the knowledge is documented and that knowledge is going to another person in a documented form, that is basically the explicit knowledge. So whether it is tacit knowledge or explicit knowledge, the knowledge is transferred to the person, and this is the layer at which the user is going to have interaction or contact with the system. Now how it happens, if you look at it, so whenever you are going to transfer any knowledge, okay, whether it is tacit or explicit, so you are going to use a medium, right? And at the same time there is a context to that. Okay, so this context is not always represented in a knowledge base or repositories. Knowledge base or repositories only have knowledge, it has only explicit knowledge base, but this knowledge base is without a context. Okay, so somebody has made a program, so program is available. Okay, the how to code the program is available, but in what context this program was written, what is the use of this, this is not available. So this context is not represented in the knowledge base or repository, right? But when we are talking about tacit knowledge, okay, and when it is being transferred through explicit mechanism, okay, then it is possible maybe that through informal mechanism or either through conversation or through technology using whiteboards or other things, you are going to add some context when you are going to transfer tacit knowledge from one person to another person. Now if you look at this, say not through conversations or other forms, the tacit knowledge is being communicated between the two people. but this is a knowledge base which does not have a context, and this is basically being formally transferred from this person to another person or from this person to another person. All right, so it may be somewhere in between the extremes of knowledge without a context with knowledge with full of context, right? It could be tacit or it could be explicit in nature. Now, how it is happening? If you are talking about technology, basically, if you look at this, most cases we are using internet, okay, or web. Okay. So web browsers basically acts as an interface, okay, because it helps you to access the KM system, okay, from your computer terminals, which is connected to the web. So when you're going to access to the KM system or the repositories that is explicitly deposited in the repository, what you do? You try to see that how this can be accessed. Okay, so access point is basically the through internet, and you are connected through the web, and as a client, you have access to the portions which you require to access, the relevant portion of the KM system, which is going to be useful for you. Now, if you want to see that how it can be optimized, okay, so what needs to be done? So you have to see that the technology that you are using, okay, the networks, the other kind of things, okay, the servers, okay. So this is much better so that you don't have any issue related to access, issue related to the memory or the servers, okay, or when you're going to look at graphics or whatever it is. I mean, if you look into the technical aspects of this, so that you make sure that technical part is the technical mechanism is optimized to such an extent so that you have access to the content in any form, okay, and that is the advantage of this kind of platform when you are going to use it. Similarly, if you look at this when you are using internets or intranets, okay, so you are going to see that the information that is available is consistent, logical and systematic, so that you are going to make use of it in a proper way. Now, see, if you are going to use the internet or intranet, so you are going to get the relevant information which is required without any problem, provided the technology is seamless. It you have the kind of technology which is required to have access, whether it is text or videos or graphics or whatever it is, okay. And then basically intranet, most of the organizations now have intranets both, which help them to have access to the KM system. And similarly, you also need to see that how you can optimize the video content. So you have to see that when you're going to optimize text content, the kind of system that you require is not that sophisticated, is not that configured well. But when you're going to have video content, you have to see that yes, it has the requisite bandwidth and other kind of things, so that you can make use of these kind of things, or actually could look into the processes, because most of the processes which are observed and recorded, and if it's available with the KM system, cannot be accessed if the system does not allow you to have access to it in a proper way, right? So, and that is why you need to see that how you can optimize it. Similarly, you have to see that when you are using different kind of platforms, right? You need to see that whether you can integrate whatever content you are having across platforms, and whether it can be viewed across platforms or not. Okay, so the repository is irrespective of the kind of platform you are using, whether you are using Windows, whether you are using Android based platforms, or whether you are using say Apple based platform and this Apple based platforms. Okay, whatever platform you are using. So any platform that is web based, okay, you have to see that you have to integrate it, and so that you are going to use, okay, a language which is universal across these platforms, and that is where we are going to use the HTML. It is popularly popularly known as hypertext markup language. It is basically the most widely used language in the web format because it provides you same access across all platforms. Okay, that's why it is required that any content must be created and posted in HTML format. And if it is done in that way, so whether you are using Apple computers or Windows computers, okay, Windows based computers, you can have access to that, right? Then moving to the next part, that second is access and authentication layer. Okay. Now when it comes to access and authentication, okay, there are certain issues that how we are going to have access, okay, and how we are going to make sure that yes, the information that we are going to have access authenticated. Okay. So there are a lot of issues related to access, because you know that not everybody have access rights, okay, to have data related to the KM system, okay, and that is where you provide access privileges, okay, to people concerned at different levels in the organizations, right? So you have to assign rights to permit different level of access to data. For example, at lower level, they can have access to only part of the data, while top management may have access to different kind of data, right? So and you know that similarly, you also have different formats of access. Like you can, they can read it only, they can write it, or they can interact and delete. So at lower level, they might have access to data which they can read only, or they cannot write, or they cannot edit or delete certain things. But at the middle level or senior level, managers may have different kind of privileges where they can interact with the data, they can make changes and modifications in the data. Then authentication is provided by certain softwares, like you may have firewalls between the extranet and the internet, so that the materials that is coming from outside is not being hacked or attacked by say various viruses and these kind of things. Similarly, it is very very important for having a backup data, because suppose there are certain problems, your data is hacked or attacked, okay, then the data is gone, so whatever repositories that you have created, okay, become a wasteful expenditure. So you also need to create backups, okay, at different areas, and then you also have mirror sites, staging areas, where you can basically create similar data sets, provided your KM access is not working or there are certain problems. So you can use it as a backup to restore the databases. And the important point is virtual private networks. And when I'm talking about virtual private networks, basically these provide you fixed to fixed point communication lines, right? Like I am here sitting over here, somebody is there in a different part of the country. So we are communicated through that, and through email, through faxes, through other communication modes like internet and other things. So so that we can connect, okay. And only thing that you need to ensure that it is secure, so that whatever is being communicated is safe, and because it is, it may be privileged information or copyrighted information related to the organization. Now how we go about standardization and creating a protocol for these kind of networks, because it is within the organization, so they use different kind of say systems or networks for this purpose, okay, so that the data is safe, protected, it is not hacked, okay. And these are some of the examples which is given here, and you can see this these are different kind of standards and protocols for networks that is used. Like you have lightweight directory access protocol known as LDAP, then you have point to point tunneling protocol. So these are the different kind of standard protocols that are used. Then you have secure my standard that let users send secure email messages using certificate based encryption authentication. So suppose you are sending mail and the other person received, then down the line you find that okay, this is sent through this, so this shows that yes, it has gone through the secured MIME, so that and this is certified, okay, this database is certified. So the it is only between the sender and the receiver, right? So that whatever information is being sent is secure, and it is it does not have access to other persons, right? Then you have virtual card, okay, for storing and presenting say contact or other kind of information in the system. Then you signed objects, okay, basically it's a software, okay, or document distribution, basically which is done by technical programs like JavaSoft or Java Archive specifications. So basically we are using these kind of things, networks, for these reasons. As I told you earlier, for access, for security, for creating backups. So whatever network protocols we are using here, that is for these kind of things, so that it is safe. Then other form of authentication that is used in today's world is biometrics. Biometrics very popular form of authentication, so that the information is not accessed by the wrong kind of persons. Okay, so like you go for face recognition or voice recognition or fingerprint recognitions. So suppose you have access to a system, you are sitting in front of a PC, so you cannot open it unless the system recognizes either your voice or fingerprints or face, right? So these are the new technologies that is being used by the organizations, okay, so that you have access to the system, okay, in a very transparent manner, so that other persons or other people or other third parties are not able to get into the system and get the information that is going to provide you some kind of, say, advantage, right? So biometrics is being widely used these days, okay, and it could have different formats, as I told you. Now, apart from this, we are moving to the third part, that is collaborating, filtering, and intelligent layer. Now, collaborative filtering and intelligent layer, what is that? Okay, is basically it's when you are going to, say, access information or interact with the system to access information, you need authentication and access systems to access it. Okay, but before you access it, you have to see that how the knowledge is being filtered by the system. Okay, so this filtering and intelligence layer basically is going to help you to see that you get the relevant information. Okay, so you use tags, attributes, other knowledge elements. Okay, and there are basically either automated procedures or manual procedures through which you will be able to get relevant informations. Okay, so just like in case of artificial intelligence, what happens, suppose you want to access certain information related particular tasks to solve your problem. Now when you are searching for that, this collaborating filtering or intelligence layer will help you to get the relevant information. So it filters out all irrelevant informations based on knowledge element or attributes or tags that you have typed over there, right? Then you have two kind of structures of the knowledge management system, right? It could be static or dynamic. Static means you know that whenever you create a document, okay, and then you have access to the document through the KM system, okay, and this document can be accessed directly or through hyperlinks. There are two options to access the document, wherever it is uploaded in the system or the repositories. Okay, now this when you are talking about static structures, it means the nature of the document does not changes. Okay, it could be video files, it could be sound files, it could be text files, whatever it is, right? So what actually happens, you are moving from one system, one document to another document, and each document there is a link which takes you to another document. Okay, so once you activate these hyperlinks, it means that you are moving from one document to another document. Say for example, if you are searching certain things on Wikipedia, okay, so if you look at Wikipedia, the first page provides you superficial information. Okay, so if you want to get deeper into that information, then what you do, there are links that is provided, okay, in the text, and if you click that link, it will take you to another set of information. Okay, and from there you can go much deeper. So depending upon the kind of information or the depth information or the level of information that you are looking forward to, you move from one set to set of information to another set of information. Now when I am talking about dynamic structures, it means that the nature of document keep on changing, in the sense that when you are able to manage changes in the documents. Okay, so sometimes it is not possible in a static documents like a video file or sound files, but if it is a text file or other kind of files, that is where you are going to make certain changes. Okay, so it becomes dynamic, but video files or sound files are more static in nature. Okay, see this. Now if you look at this, these are the different kind of things. See, there is a sound, there is a system, here it is. Now if it talks about two both kind of things, static structure and dynamic structure. So this is a text file, this could be a mail, this is a video, this is a sound, okay, so and this is a GIF, okay, this is a portal, this is a graph. Now if you look at this, how this is connected, okay, and here the access is there. Now if you look at this, you have access to this, this is there, you have access to this, but you cannot make changes in these files, right? You can only see that. So most of the time you will find that the nature is more static compared to dynamic, right? and then you move to this, and then it takes you to this. Suppose you are moving at watching say certain text, and then text you find a link to the video, then you can go to the video, right? Okay, so that is how it moves. Okay, but it is static in nature because you cannot change anything out of it, right? So when you are moving from static to dynamic structures, basically you have to see that the navigational issues are not there. Okay, and it is collaborative in the sense that you are able to move from one to the other one, right? For example, from here you are moving to here, then you are moving here, then again you can move to this place, right? So you make sure that it is, there is a extensive collaborative authoring. It means that it takes you from one place to another place. Okay, and there's orphan links are not there. It means that there's no link from where you don't end up anywhere, right? So these, you need to avoid these kind of links so that you get complete information, and then you have to see that. But it does not actually happen usually, because most, see for example, from here you don't have any link. Okay, so say for example, if you go from here, you go from here, you can go to this place here, here, and then it takes you to here. But suppose if you are here in a Word file, you open a Word file, and then you move to this. Okay, but beyond that, there is no information. Okay, so you are stuck up, and does not give you quality information, right? So sometimes it does not create complex informations because of the static nature. So you have to see that kind of information that is available in the repository is not only static but also dynamic in the structures. Then you have virtual folders. Okay, virtual folders, like you have folders somewhere else which can be accessed. Okay, in different ways, like through navigations, by searching the metadata, looking into the content, or by subscription. Okay, because these folders are not available to you all the time, but you have to search for it. Okay, for example, people use cloud computing today. Okay, or you have Google Docs, right? So data is not actually with you, but if you go to Google Drive, and then you get the information, right, through navigations, or you are searching metadata. There's a certain subscription based databases. Suppose you want to have access to that, then you have to look at the metadata. Okay, and then you look for the content which you are looking forward to, like if you are doing research in the area of business, then you have EBSCO databases, right? So EBSCO database automatically does not provide you data. Okay, because these are metadata which are classified data into different formats related to different business areas, then you have to look for the content. But these are not available freely, but you have to subscribe these kind of databases so that you can have access to the relevant information. Okay, now this virtual folder is very very important today, because you don't need to say have all kind of repositories with you, but also have repositories elsewhere which can be used and as it is required, or you connect to these repositories, but actually it is not with you. Okay, but and you do not run the risk of being perceived as useless. Okay, because in that case, suppose you have very less repositories, so if you have subscription or access to data, these kind of databases, then you can use it. Okay, so these kind of functionalities are very very important. Okay, so that you become relevant, not useless. Okay, and similarly you have to see that you add to the repositories without any effort on the part of the user, because you have access to those repositories which are there in the virtual folders, right? Then moving to automatic full text indexing. Basically, if you look at the collaborating filtering layer, okay, which is responsible for indexing content in a manner that permits fast retrieval, okay, through multiple search mechanisms, right? So it is, the data is classified in such a way so that it filters out the relevant information based on the content that you are looking for. And it is very fast because the retrieval is easy, and you have access to it using certain search mechanism. Then when you go for meta tagging, as I told you, you see meta tags are basically nothing else, but these are the documents and contents which can be made available using certain softwares, right? And these also have certain context, like who published the document, when it was modified, who reviewed it, who approved it, what is the size of document. So you have all the information related to the document or the content that you want to make use of. Okay, so and now there are softwares which do this job. So you will find all the data related to the document, like the source of the data, approval, what is the size, what is the files. For example, if you right click a word file, then you get all the information, right? When it was created, when it was modified, what is the size, all kind of things, okay? So this is what we know as meta tagging of a document or content, and that is done automatically by the software. Then from client server to agent computing, okay, in this actually what happens, client or server setup, the network load primarily exists between the client and the server, okay? So there is a client who is basically sitting on the PC, and there is a server through which you are connected, okay? And then through networks or internets, you are going to have information related to that one, okay? But in the agent or computing model, what happens, this load is shifted to the space between the agent server, okay? So you don't have to worry about it, okay? So the load on the network is reduced, okay? And this basically, and that is why it is very important to have client servers, okay? So that the network load on the network is very less, okay? Now you look at this, this is a direct network activity between the client and server, and here you have agent in between that, in between the server and the client, which basically reduces the network activities. So from the server it goes to the agent, and from there it is going over there, and similarly from the client it goes to the agent, and then it goes to the server, okay? So the agent might moderate, filter, collaborate, whatever is required by the system, right? Now what is the benefits of having an agent, okay, mobile agent, okay? See, the benefit is that it is free to move around the network, have multiple hosts, okay? If it is created in one execution environment, it can transfer its state, okay, from one code to another code, okay? And that is why if you look at this figure again, you find that, okay, this is in a moving position, okay? So it depending upon the context, it is going to move from here to here to here to here, and that basically reduces your network activities, and that is why these are the benefits of having a mobile agent, right? Then what are the benefits? Actually, if you look at it, basically it acts on a real time basis, reduces your network load, and also follows the protocols, okay? And it can go for all kind of not only synchronous but asynchronous and autonomous execution. So you, since it is automated softwares, if you look at this, you don't need to make any effort. The mobile agent does its job automatically because it is connected to the softwares, okay? And it also integrate, and seamless integration is there, and with different kind of data, okay, the information, okay? And they are fault tolerant, okay? So these are some of the benefits of having a mobile agent in between the system. If you look at this, you can see how between the client and the server this agent is going to work, okay? Then you also have push and pull model of deliveries, okay? Basically they embody the internet push model. Basically there is nothing else but whatever information is coming, it is passing on to you through news, bulletins, warning, notifications, right? And the strength is that it brings knowledge centered applications, okay? So these are some of the benefits. Then the next one is application layer. Like you have applications such as directories, yellow pages, tools, video conferencing softwares and hardwares, and conventional decision support systems. These are the application softwares which are put into system so that you can access to them to get the relevant information, okay, or through them the relevant information. So that is nothing else but it's a different kind of softwares and hardwares, okay? Like you can have yellow pages, okay, directories, and these video conferencing softwares, or you have decision support systems which is a part of the system, okay? Then moving to the transport layer, how the information moves, okay? And that is more technical in the sense because you have internet protocol, that is how you are going to connect through the network or the system, okay? And you have web servers or mail servers or virtual private network to support a remote communication access. For example, I'm sitting in say Kharagpur and I want to communicate to somebody in Delhi. Then this VPN actually support remote communications and connectivity, and even it also supports basically streaming audio and video through central servers, okay? Then the next part is what you call the middleware and the legacy integration layer. This basically provide connection between the legacy data and existing new systems. Suppose you have WKM system and then you already have certain systems, so how that old system is going to be integrated with the new KM system, okay? So the middleware layer provides connectivity between old and new data formats, and that is basically done through the web front end. Then ultimately you have the repositories layer, and this repository layer is basically is the bottom layer, okay, which consists of databases, okay, web archives, legacy data, documents, other repositories, okay, maybe in explicit documented forms, videos, and are different kind of files. So this repository layer is very important, because this repository layer actually that is what you are going to have access, okay, and then you have middlewares, transport layers, application layer, then you have this what you call collaborative filter layer, agent layer, and then you have access layer, and file then ultimately you have what you call the interface layer. And that is how we have these 7 layers in the system, starting with interface layer to repository layer. And each what we have discussed there is that how each layer works and how each layer is getting connected and integrated through different layers, okay. So that is what we have discussed in this part. So this is how we are going to conclude the 5th module, okay, middleware repositories layer. Thank you.